afternoon and welcome once again to a chilly Rybinsk, this time for the men's 15 kilometer freestyle skating. And we pick up the action with Hans Christer Holund of Norway, 25 years of age, a member of the Lind Ski Club, and alongside myself, David Goldstrom, Mike Dixon. And it's exactly the same course as the women undertook earlier today, Mike, except that it's three loops of 5,200 meters or thereabouts.
Well, David, they're going to get used to this track if it's three times, but it's, they recognize it as a very difficult course. There's very limited rest, and a total climb today of just over 500 meters within the 15 kilometers. Very tough course and conditions.
As you see Alexander Bezmetnik get underway, I think the most important point so far in this race is the performance of Alexander Legkov, the Sochi Olympic 50 kilometer champion, who's likely raced this season, Mike, but has made a really impressive start. And of the early leaders, he wears bib number four. He's making all the marks.
He's certainly setting the pace, but a very poor start to his season after all the success, his Olympic 50 kilometer success. But only one result in the top 30 earlier this season. That was 15th position in Lillehammer, 10 kilometer freestyle.
And all in Swiss black, the amazing Dario Cologna. And Dario Cologna, at the age of 28, setting out. He's pretty popular here, and he likes coming to Russia because his record here is pretty good. He's had three victories coming to Russia this time, but he always enjoys coming here. So there you can see Legkov at 3.5 kilometers. Very early days there, but that's a good start, 8:42.8. And these conditions are pretty tough, both in terms of the cold. What about the course, Mike? It's pretty remorseless.
It really is. We see the flat section in the stadium, and that's very deceptive because that's the only flat part. They're just basically going up and down the banks of the river, or of the old river Volga, and it is really testing in a very small area, very compact, but continual climbs and very short recoveries.
Perrier, and still some way to go, and it's really tough when you go out as early as Legkov, because of course everybody can feed off your different time splits, but on the other hand you just run your own race. And like you said, Mike, perhaps after the stress of a season leading up to ultimately a fantastic success in the Olympic Games, you just calm down and then you build up again. It's not uncommon in quite a lot of sports in the post-Olympic year to, you know, just take it. It's very hard to stay at the top every year.
And I suppose when you reach all your dreams, the gold medal in the 50K, the prestige race, the toughest race on the calendar, and he took his gold medal there, silver in the 4x10 relay. So a lot of marketing this summer for Legkov, and I think he maybe got carried away with that, but he's back today, serious contender for a title here.
Just saw Roland Clara going through in the red of Italy. I still can't get used to those red suits this year.
Why?
It's bizarre. And Häkkinen now, 42. All of them chasing Legkov. This is really interesting. Has Legkov got his pacing right? Well,
I think with his low ranking, David, he's got no position to get a later start, to get feed off from other athletes ahead of him. So you just sense maybe he's gone out here at an incredible attack pace, maybe just a little too hard too soon.
Well, only time will tell. This is Häkkinen, who perhaps one would think of more in classic style. He was a world champion in classic style in Oslo over today's distance, 15 kilometers.
As his coaches say, David, Häkkinen often has some poor days, but he can have incredible days, amazingly successful days, like at the World Champs in Oslo when he took the 15K Classic gold medal there.
Holland chasing Legkov, and this doesn't look too bad a performance here by Holland.
He's very lightly raced at World Cup. The Norwegians really only including him in the Oslo 50 kilometer. just a couple of times. They took him to Lahti once, and they've taken him here, obviously, now. So only 5 World Cups experience for Holland.
And just to confirm that neither Martin Jonsson-Sundby, the World Cup leader, commanding World Cup leader, ahead of Petter Northug, both of those for Norway. Kalle Halvorsen there, absent from today's race, recovering from the exertions of the Tour de Ski. Poltoranin not here for Kazakhstan. Daniel Rickardsson also another absentee for Sweden. But Kolonia, Belov, Legjanin, Harvey and Clara, those are the men in the top 15 who are participating today.
Besmernik, he finished 19th overall in the Tour de Ski, so still fatigued, I think, from that. In fact, he was just ahead of Andrew Musgrave in the Tour de Ski. Andy finishing 20th.
For France, Adrien Bachscheider, interesting youngster at the age of 22. I think this young man has got a future ahead of him, and that's not a bad start.
It's a very good start, and the experience with Magnificat and in the French team and Duvillard. Well, there he is, Magnificat. I thought he would, well, he will be setting the early time, maybe, or level pegging with Lekhoff.
I think he's ahead of Lekhoff, and there you have the confirmation by 1.8 seconds at 3.5 kilometers. And that's a good start by Maurice Magnificat. And as I said a few moments ago, the bookmakers making second favorite, so right up there with a chance to really produce a good result.
Very smooth, easy skiing. You need efficiency over 15 kilometers. This looks very comfortable from Utkin.
Yeah, the profile of the course looks a little bit like a roller coaster, doesn't it? It's like it's a bit like the Loch Ness Monster, really, because it's sort of up and down and up and down and up and down the whole journey.
It is, and look at way back down, you know, as we saw down that hill. This is the longest, over about 500 meters. The rest, you're just dropping off the bank and then straight back up again the riverside.
So Magnificat leading at 3.5 kilometers, but remember, still the likes of Legjanin and Sedov and Harvey to get up there, and also Belov and Ustugov and Kolonia. And then we'll have a really good idea of where we are with 11.5 kilometers to go.
Dementiev, there he is, David, looking very strong. He hasn't raced much, in fact, 3 World Cups since he came back from his ban in 2012.
Sedov, only 24 years of age, yet to podium. And interesting, again, a youngster with a fantastic junior world record, a couple of gold medals, a second and a third at junior world level. We're talking about 2008 to 2009 and 2010. So that was in the years when he was sort of around, you know, 19 and 20, now strengthening. And Alex Harvey here from the Club Nordique Mont-Saint-Anne. Not one of my favorite places in the world. Every time I've ever been there, it's always raining.
Bit like the west of Scotland.
Yeah, 26 years of age, and of course, son of the famous Pierre Harvey. But I guess, you know, having now broken his World Cup duck, albeit in a sprint, I think that he's a man in his own right now, and he's been so close to some really important, you know, race successes. He's almost there, but not quite. Klavatsky. Looking at Belov here, nice rhythm, well balanced,
very strong. He was unlucky in the Tour de Ski with a fall on the second last day, costing him some 35 seconds, and really that's as far as he finished behind the leader of the actual tour.
Belov behind Magnificat and Ustugov here. Now Ustugov, this is pretty good running by Ustugov, and he's surely going to take the lead. So 3.5 kilometers, and just look at the shoulders. Look at the way he's putting the power down.
Such a strong athlete. And with the snow crystals so sharp, David, at minus 13 here, there's such little glide factor. So you need all of your strength today, your efficiency and your strength to try and get those skis moving up the hills.
Dario Colonia. Well, he's very special, isn't he, Mike?
He's just an engine, isn't he? He's like a gifted, talented cross-country skier and so efficient on his skis.
Oh. And he goes through. That means that Ustugov, as you can see, drops into second place. Magnificat to third. And here's Legkov at the other end of the race with only, what, 1,500 meters to go. And I can tell you, if I do the comparison on times, Legkov at this point would have been, well, is actually 9.3 seconds behind Colonia, so in fourth place and ahead of Belov, actually.
So Legkov still going well, and he doesn't appear to have fatigued. That's 11.3 kilometers for him, and he's still charging, trying to stay with Colonia. Well, maybe that will be his undoing, because he's still got a way to go.
So a lot of opportunities for lesser-known Norwegians to try and make their mark. As I mentioned, the Norwegian Championships next week, and so I think everybody in the Norwegian team knows that that's the last opportunity to impress in terms of being selected. And it not only looks, not only is it is cold, it actually looks cold as well.
Earlier, of course, the snow falling for in the women's race, not the case this time. De Fabiani wearing that different bib because he's leading the under 23 ranking, which I think is a great new part of World Cup racing. It recognizes the strength of this man.
And you can see Legkov again, you see, up there and with a commanding time advantage over the likes of De Fabiani.
You just get a sense of the climb now, David. This is a shorter climb. This is the typical climb as it snakes up and down the riverbank. And it's severe, it really is a severe course. Just a hard grafting, hard working, energy zapping course. Clara, 13 off at, well, just under half distance.
Yeah, Rybinsk that lies at the confluence of two great rivers in Russia, the Volga and the Shekhsna. And it's historically one of the oldest Slavic settlements historically, and the records go back to something as early as 1071 for Rybinsk. It's had various names throughout the age, and there are in this region about 200,000 people who live in this part of the world.
It's quite amazing. It's so every time we come here, it's around about this time of year. I cannot think of any year where it's been warmer than minus 10. We get guaranteed weather here just to the northeast of Moscow.
Now Häkkinen, he was behind, obviously everybody's behind Colonia at 3.5 kilometers, so he was 12.9 seconds down behind Colonia, so we won't get a check on that. I'm just trying to work out the difference here. It's only three. Yeah, Häkkinen to Legkov, that's a big gap.
Well, Häkkinen started well, but this relentless up and down the riverbanks is beginning to get to him. This is the longest recovery in the course. You only get about 21 seconds of decent recovery.
Here is Alexander Legkov coming home now. 31 years of age from, well, I know, one of your favorite Russian cities, Khantymansisk.
Very flat there in Khantymansisk.
Takes forever to get there, but he's getting a really good cheer, and so he should. I mean, he's famous. I mean, you know, I just remember last year, President Putin, after the disappointment of all the cross-country races, and suddenly in the very last race, Legkov and Legzhanin, they really brought it home and saved the day.
They did. They absolutely did. And Putin was in the audience that day and, of course, met them afterwards. This looks an amazing time, David. I think Legkov has dropped off the pace quite noticeably in the last 1.5 kilometers.
Look really trim to me.
Yes, he's looking much better than he did in November, December, January, and then he's gone away and got his form back, got his skiing legs back. I'm just thinking, David, Legkov's had too many fourth positions here. Back in 2009. He was fourth here in the 30-kilometer national champs, fourth in the 15-kilometer World Cup here in 2009, fourth in the 15-kilometer free in 2012. So hopefully that result's good enough for the podium today.
Well, there you can see how much he is down on Legkov. So these are really good racers. I mean, and Legkov, in one of his very rare appearances this season, is taking some important scalps here. Whatever happens to Legkov, whether he stays on the podium or stays within the podium range, I think he's going to take a lot of confidence out of this race, because he's going to get a real boost, because it's a really good barometer race for him as to his fitness and his condition over this particular distance.
I think Legkov absolutely needed that closing in on the World Champs. Dementiev, he started really well. In fact, he's still going really well. Looks strong, very dynamic. Could this be a moment for Dementiev where he gets invited back into the World Cup team on a regular basis, not just the World Cup, which comes back home to Russia?
Well, his big positional moves have come after the first 3,500 meters. He was outside the top 10 there, and he's moved very solidly into the top 10. Sveen here of Norway. That one 15-kilometer race at altitude, and Sveen was in 26th place in that. And you can hear the Norwegian coaches in the background there really encouraging him. But Legkov, interesting, still with 5 kilometers to go. Well, still over a third of the race to go, as you see Volshensev. Interesting Volshensev, because he's been there or thereabouts throughout the whole race, top 10. And coming up to 11.9 kilometers. And just having a look, he was 33 seconds down on Colonia, the previous check we had.
Some big names, David, not getting close to Legkov. So as more and more numbers cross the line, Legkov must be feeling better and better. He still knows, of course, Colonia is still out there at the tail end of the field and getting all the information, but he's got to be feeling quite comfortable in that seat.
Yeah, just a Turishev you saw finishing there, lost a lot of time, almost doubled the deficit to over a minute between 6.9 and 11.9 kilometers. So that really was his undoing there, because he just lost position and pace. And Legkov well wrapped up and just has to wait and see. I just, you know, wonder whether he can get on the podium. When you look at it, round about the 10-kilometer mark, Legkov still vying with the podium possibility with Belov and also Ustigov. There's not much between Ustigov and Belov at the moment, as we pick up yet another Russian here, Chernusov.
Chernusov, again, another one of these medal winners from Sochi who hasn't had a good start to the season. And he married this summer, Selina Gasparin, the star, the biathlon star from Switzerland. So life-changing for him back in the summertime.
And another athlete between 6.9 and 11.9. Actually losing the best part of 30 seconds. So clearly that's been a crucial part of the race for one or two. You see him with 1,500 meters to go here now, and he's not going to make up any of that deficit.
Dementiev, Olympic gold in the skiathlon back in 2006 Olympics, and then silver medal in the 50 kilometer.
Yeah, remember that race well, came very, very late into the stadium there in Torino, or Pragelato, as it really was up there. And Dementiev, not bad, not bad. He was 36 seconds off for the leaders at 10,000 meters. And so he's made a little bit, and that's at least going in the right direction.
I think that's a very good performance, son. Probably the best since he came back after serving his ban. He hasn't performed well in his few World Cups that he's attended.
Clara, who's been solidly in the top 10, just looking at him at 11.9 kilometers. And the relative, well, he was 28 seconds down. And just looking at that, 23, yeah, that gap hasn't really closed.
I still think, David, there's still fatigue in the legs. What, 2 weeks after the Tour de Ski's finished, Clara did brilliantly well. The fastest time on the final day up Alpshire Meath, finished sixth overall. And I know it's the same for Cologne, but there's still fatigue in the legs. And this man as well, Volsenchev, 15th in the Tour de Ski. They must still be feeling it.
This is not a bad run. Volsenchev making up ground, biting into the time of Dario Cologna and putting himself in with an outside chance at the moment here of getting to the podium, but only 1500 meters left once he reached this timing point. He's probably running out of snow, but he's doing all his best work late on in the race.
He seems to have really picked it up, and his face covered in the tape, the anti-frost nip. When all the blood is required in your major muscle groups, your earlobes, your cheeks, of course your fingers often get frost nip in these temperatures. They just go white.
Häkkinen going backwards, I have to say. And at the moment, 41.9 seconds. And on the evidence of what we've got here is that he's going to lose even more time.
A depressing thought when his split times are more and more negative and he's trying his absolute hardest. It's a tough one.
Holland, interesting. He was right there for, well, certainly the first half of the race, but the second half of the race, he's been found out and again leaking time very seriously.
Clara, a good glide on his skis behind Chernusov.
Well, at these temperatures, it shouldn't really be that difficult, the waxing process.
Not really. It's the base of the ski, which allows any friction to come off the base to allow it to glide faster.
So, Clara is the better of the two here, remember. Chernusov, fifth place. Actually, sorry, I've got that wrong. I mean, Chernusov is looking at his finish. Roland Clara,
Yes, had been absorbed there by a minute. Magnificat, he started strong, very strong. Hit this course is beginning to get to him. It's still a good time. He must be looking for, what, a top five, maybe even a top three still.
Well, at 6.9 kilometers, he was, what, 20-odd seconds behind Cologna. Cologna, of course, yet to get to this point. And Dementiev now. Last time we saw Dementiev, he was 33 seconds behind. That's Cologna, but we have to keep recognizing here that Legkov is still sitting in the big chair. There he is.
And he must be feeling better and better with the big name Chernusov, Dementiev coming across the line.
But I think the big danger to him is Ustugov, who we haven't seen for a while. Ustugov and Legkov were separated by 3 seconds at 6.9 kilometers in favor of Legkov. So that's the big question. Legkov really pushing strongly, not only from the start, but in the middle part of the race.
I think Legkov's only weak part, he's very strong in the early part. I think he slowed his pace slightly, showing maybe his recent hard training still in his legs, but I think he lost a few seconds over that final 1.5 kilometer.
Well, here's a man who's lost an ocean of time, Legzhanin.
Just doesn't look comfortable. There's a stiffness, a heaviness in his legs. And Ahil Velikianin, like Lekov, the focus on Chernyshov again will be on the World Championships.
More than a minute behind Lekov? Absolutely. I mean, that's discouraging for him.
You can just feel that the further he climbs up this hill, the slower the leg tempo is getting, a man who is not on form.
When you win an Olympic gold medal, particularly in the 50-kilometer distance, you are a hero forever. And you're also a star forever. And there's something that happens. You stand tall in every race, don't you? And you sort of sense that, you know, even though we haven't seen much of Lekov, he's come back and he's put in wherever he finishes today. And I don't think he's going to be out of the top five the way things are looking. I mean, I think that's a remarkably good performance.
It is, and most of Russia watched that day when he took his gold medal, and Russia won 2 and 3. It was a great day for Russian cross-country skiing, probably the greatest day ever.
That's not bad, is it? Belov.
That's very good.
That's Belov. Now, Belov at 11.9 kilometers, 29.39 to Legkov's 29.49, so 10 seconds in there. Now Ustugov coming through. Ustugov, who was traveling at about the same pace as Colonia, as Lekov. And at 6.9 kilometers, Colonia had a 10 second break over Belov, a 17 second break over Ustugov. And here we are at 11.9 kilometers, and this is going to be the telling one, isn't it?
It is. Now, if Colonia, that's a great split, 12.7 up. Now, Colonia, you'd expect, will go ahead of Ustugov. Now, Ustugov needs to hang on in there if he wants to challenge Lekov's time.
Yeah, traveling together, and look how close that is. And Belov up there in second place.
Hey, Lekov, third position there. Could this be the day that he breaks that horrible fourth position which he's had here three times previously?
I mean, Magnificat behind Colonia at 11.9 kilometers. He was 28 seconds down and hasn't really lost much, hasn't really, well, he's gained a bit, but not significantly.
All these hills look the same, but this is 13.5 kilometer. Magnificat has just gone through. Each hill, each climb is like a mirror image of the other. Well done to the spectators. And I think it's still Lekov who's had the biggest cheer each time he came through the stadium and when he finished.
That man there, no gloves. So Clara, 13, 14 seconds. This is pretty good from Roland Clara.
I thought he was going to make top five today, and well, I think he may still just do that.
Yeah, but still there are men who can push him there, but Lekov, another scalp, 30 seconds. Just trying to look at the last check that we had with Lekov and Clara, and it was actually 22 seconds. At 11.9 kilometers, so you can see how tough Lekov really saw the race out well.
Is Lekov beginning to believe that he's on the podium?
Now, how can he wear bib number 4 for a man who's finished fourth on so many big occasions?
It's incredible, isn't it? And it's a little unfair for him. You could say he's not in the race where he's in the group that you can get your easier split times. He was breaking new ground, but purely because of his world rankings, his poor performance early in the season.
Well, at the moment, he's definitely in the first four.
And if Ustugov sticks in there with Colonia, maybe Ustugov can pull back that, what was it, 4 or 5 seconds.
Remember, Ustugov is the sprinter. And if he's got speed at the end...
And Lekov isn't the sprinter.
He may, as it were, unwrap himself to go for the podium.
And look at Belov here. It's that metronome, that easy flow that he has. I love the way he drops through the right side, and he's easy with his left leg up into the hill. No wasted energy.
10-second advantage he had over Lekov at 11.9 kilometers. Pretty well the same. But 1,500 meters, he should be able to, you would think, hold that. this is not a bad performance by Holland. 14.6 seconds the deficit, so he's going to be either just in or just outside the top 10. Difficult to tell at the moment.
I think he'll be happy with that. He did finish 16th.
That will be a personal best.
It will be 16th, you're right. He was 16th in Oslo in the 50 kilometer.
So now the moment of truth here for Colonia and Belov. 12 seconds Colonia up on Belov at 11.9 kilometers. And you can see that he still got the advantage there. Pretty well matched themselves there from 11.9 to 13.5.
And look at this, as soon as Colonia wanted past, Ustigov put in a little turn of pace. As you said, he's a sprinter.
Yeah. And there you have the situation with 1,500 meters to go. And look at that, Legkov and Ustigov. Legkov with about 8 seconds advantage. So, Ustigov ahead at the moment. It's not a bad race, but he just isn't going to make any headlines, is he?
He's not, and Magnificat, he loves racing in Russia. Of course, the French team winning the relay bronze medal at the Olympic Games. I think a little bit of a surprise, but certainly something great to carry away from his Olympic memories.
It's all about the finish now, isn't it? And now Legkov sitting in the finish there, 37:29.2.
He will be so disappointed. We know Belov's ahead of him and likely to be. We know Colonia is. And it's whether Ustigov can find something special.
There wasn't much between Ustigov and Legkov. This is a set off 49 and now to Belov. So Belov,
he's picking his pace up there. Alex Harvey trying to live with it.
Dario Colonia and Ustigov. Ustigov taking the lead. And Ustigov is bound to sprint once he gets into the stadium here. Colonia doesn't really have to worry because he just has to keep tabs on him, really.
But strangely, every time Colonia makes a fight to go past him, Ustigov puts in a sprint and doesn't allow him to. Very frustrating for Colonia.
Well, here we go, and this is towards the finish here. Colonia heading for his fourth success here in Russia. And Mike, the first time he would have won a 15-kilometer World Cup race in skating freestyle.
That's surprising when he's won so much in cross-country skiing. Of course, he won the Olympic 15-kilometer 2010, but never a World Cup in freestyle 15.
So here goes Ustigov and Sedov, actually, in the background. Ustigov and Sedov goes through, and there's the race there coming through towards the finish. Belov.
Harvey challenging, and Harvey always finishes strong.
Belov, Belov takes the lead and pushes Legkov out of the big chair. That was predictable, to be honest.
It was, and Belov still hoping he can hang on to a third place.
So Belov with Ustigov and Colonia to come home. Those are the two men out on the course. Legkov sitting in second place, and the way this is going, Mike, you know what's going to happen here, don't you? He started number four, he wears bib number four, four has been his hoodoo number, and Legkov is set to finish fourth, because look at the way that Ustigov is finishing here ahead of Colonia. The time is for Colonia, but Ustigov surely has gone into third place. I think he has.
Yes, he has.
And Colonia wins the race. Belov is second, Ustigov is third, and Legkov is pushed down to fourth place and misses out by 7 seconds. And that is really tough.
What a turnaround. Ustigov at 11.9. He had to find, what, nearly 8 seconds. And that's an incredible turnaround. And the pace that he just wasn't going to allow Colonia to pass him. What a fighter he is.
And you've got to feel for Legkov, because he sort of, in a way, deserves to be on the podium.
He does. And this is good news for Colonia in terms of the Distance World Cup. He's going to pull a huge amount of points back, 100 points back of Jonsrud Sundby. So maybe only, what, 30 points separating them now.
Yeah, Jonsrud Sundby still with 1,189 points. He's not here, but Colonia, he's moved up from 641 to 741, although he still stays in fourth place.
Yes, and in the distance race alone, Colonia now on 479 with Jonsrud Sundby on 528, so close the gap massively.
Well, that's his fourth victory in Russia. And just thinking about some of the that's the second podium in a row for Ustigov. Fourth victory, as we've said, for Colonia in Russia. And Belov, well, what a follow-up to the Tour de Ski to be the runner-up here.
And the spectators say, well, Russia second, third, fourth, fifth. That's why they're giving it so much support.
Well, Ustigov is a man who I first remember coming to know at Universiad races when he was demolishing the opposition then, and he continues to grow in strength all the time. Belov, this is very much a personal best for him in this sort of distance race here for Belov, and that also bodes well for the World Championships. So think about that 4x10 kilometer relay team. Russia could have a very big say in that particular medal chase. So I hope you've enjoyed it from Mike Dixon and myself, David Goldstrom. Bye-bye.